Today's featured guest, Catherine Austin Fitts from Solari.com. Well, it's a pleasure to welcome back to the show the president of Solari and publisher of the Solari Report, former Assistant Secretary of Housing and Federal Housing Commissioner, and it's just great to have Catherine Austin Fitts on the show. Hello.
Chris, great to be back.
It's a pleasure, and start off today with your latest big report on infrastructure. You know, this is so key, and it seems to be something that we have forgotten here in the United States. I mean, there's a lot of literature that seems to propose that the United States pulled itself out of the Great Depression and became sort of an economic powerhouse, at least in part, by building up the roads, the railways, the airports, and supporting infrastructure. It creates jobs. It makes a more productive and efficient society. And we're seeing other countries follow that blueprint, such as China. You're concerned that we might be missing the significance of infrastructure.
I looked at infrastructure only because it was popping up in the news. And the question in my mind was, why? We know that certainly in the overt economy, the U.S. has let the infrastructure run down, but that wasn't my primary focus. If you're going to keep global growth going, particularly in the emerging markets, you're going to have to build infrastructure forward. And so we see the BRIC nations pushing to build that infrastructure forward, as you know they should and they must and they need to, and the U.S. and G7 kind of balking and getting upset as the emerging markets and the BRICS push by them. And as you mentioned, China just very successfully launched the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, and I think that's got the competition revved up a little bit. Anyway, so I decided several months ago to take a look at infrastructure because it used to be my beat when I was on Wall Street. I did a lot of infrastructure financing. And I was very surprised at what I found, Chris. Infrastructure's in the news for a variety of reasons. One, of course, is the emerging markets. But the other thing is, if you look at what is happening with artificial intelligence and automation, including robotics, we're about to break loose an enormous amount of capacity in terms of our manufacturing and production base. That's a good thing. One, because if you look at what we're doing as a society in space, if we're going to go into space in a big way, and it's clear that I think the global interests in the U.S. are planning on doing that, we need to break free. We need a much more powerful industrial base than we have, or manufacturing base than we have. So that's number one. But the other thing is, as you break through capacity, that gives us the capacity to do infrastructure globally, and I think we have underinvested. Now, at the same time, McKinsey Global Institute just did a big study or a series of studies on infrastructure and related productivity. And what they basically came to the conclusion of is between now and 2030, globally, they estimate we need to make an investment of about $57 trillion, and that doesn't include space infrastructure. And if you look at those numbers, it's happening just at the time that our capacity in the bond market and the long-term bull in the bond market is coming to the end. So the question is, how do you radically increase your investment in infrastructure at the very same time that your primary source of financing infrastructure is tapping out? We looked very much at that. You know, I've beaten the drum a lot about the fact that I think the leadership has sucked a lot of capital, including by illegal methods, out of what I call global 2.0 or the industrial economy. And basically what we've done is we've levered governments up, we've sucked the cash out and moved it into private hands or the assets. It can be the money or the assets. And we've stuck the liabilities back in, and now we're saying, oh, there's no money, oh, there's no money. Well, if you look at where we sucked all that $40 trillion to over here in global 3.0, there's plenty of money. So, but there's this bifurcation in the economy. In one part of the economy, everybody thinks the end of the world is coming, it's all going to collapse. And the other part of the economy, everybody's, you know, it's happy days are here again. And it's, you know, I don't know about you, but sometimes I feel like I have a bungee rope in my head going back and forth between the two economies, trying to make sense of what's going on. But at the heart of all of that is infrastructure, because it's traditionally been governments in the bond market that financed it. You know, but the money's sitting over here on the piled high waiting to go into the real economy. And the question is, okay, how are we going to engineer all of this, and how are we going to engineer the geopolitics of it, which, as we can tell from what happened in the markets. So my title for the infrastructure piece was Infrastructure, Conquest or Creation. And, you know, the reality is if you look at how much infrastructure we've destroyed in the last 20 years just fighting, there's a part of your budget. Anyway, infrastructure's right at the heart of sort of the question of how we move forward. And the place I came out of was I realized, you know, if you look at the kind of people you want leading, it's a very different set of people than if you want to build. So the people you use to steal the $40 trillion and move it over here to Global 3.0 are very different than the people you want reinvesting it.
Isn't that something? And it sounds, you know, like the entrepreneur has been pushed out. The rest of the folks who want to create and produce, they have to go off on their own and see if they can make it happen as entrepreneurs.
If you look at a lot of the greatest builders of infrastructure, they've been, you know, they're very entrepreneurial, they're very innovative, and they've done it through government. So it doesn't, you know, it doesn't cut private through public. It cuts more through, I'll give you a perfect example. In 1997, I was in Hong Kong, then Shanghai, and then Beijing, and I was traveling with a guy who worked for me who was a PRC citizen. We had a program at MIT that we would hire people in, and we got a lot of great sort of kids coming from China going to MIT. Anyway, he was with me, and I was there when Deng died, so we were there I was in Beijing for the week of the funeral. And there was a big war going on between the U.S. at the time. It was the Clinton administration and the Beijing administration. It was all supposedly on human rights. It was the so-called soft revolution. Words were flying back and forth, and this wonderful guy worked for me. We were sitting looking at the paper, having breakfast in Beijing, and he said, "Do you understand what this fight is about?" And I said, "No, I really don't. I really do not understand." And he said, 70 or 80% of our politicians and legislators are engineers and some economists, but basically you've got engineers. And he said, you know, 80% of yours are lawyers. And the lawyers are making more rules for the engineers and saying, you will do this. And the engineers are shrugging their shoulders and saying, how? But, you know, if you look at China right now, and I do think they're, you know, they've got a much higher percentage of engineers and builders in their back, you know, in their leadership, you know, what are they competing on? They're competing on high-speed trains. They're competing on infrastructure. They're competing on water projects. They're competing on power plants. And they're trying to build forward because they know to maintain the growth they have to, and they know to sort of establish themselves globally. And if you look at what we're doing, you know, we're kind of getting outfoxed on them in that respect. And that calls for a change of leadership. And I wanted to just read you something because I did an interview on the Solari Report. You know, I do these interviews and they turn out to be life-changing moments you didn't expect. But I did an interview with Colonel Lawrence Wilkerson, who was the chief of staff to Powell when he was over at the Joint Chiefs and then also when he was Secretary of State. It was a magical moment when I started to get into this issue of the infrastructure. So let me just read this to you. I was asking him about the 2016 elections and whether he thought we'd have a chance to have an intelligent discussion on any national security issues, and here's what he said. I would hope so, but I don't think so. And what would that consist of? In my mind, first and foremost, it would consist of articulating sometime, because I'm a military guy, a grand strategy to which the United States is going to hook itself up to its economic engine. What you've got to say is, what are we wanting to do in the world, and how are we going to refurbish our economy to do it? You aren't going to do anything of any note or any consequence unless you refurbish our economy. That means $2, $3, $4 trillion of expenditure on infrastructure. It means not building the old infrastructure, but building the new. And then he describes what that looks like. And then he says, I don't think Mario Rubio, Jeb Bush, Hillary Clinton, or anybody is capable of doing that or else wanting to do that. And I said, right. So it looks to me they're much more interested in, you know, building monopolies. And Wilkerson said, they're more interested in power, period, and they think that's where the power is. I've got news for them. I just sat on the Climate Security Working Group now for a year. I've switched over from Collaborative Institute on Oceans at UMass Boston, and we're working with DOD. We just did some sea rise charts for coastal installations like Norfolk and Mayport, San Francisco, San Diego, and so forth. Let me tell you, these entities are either going to spend millions of dollars for Netherlands-like water abatement apparatuses, walls and so forth, or they're going to relocate. This is billions and billions of dollars. Miami is going to have to do this. We've already got a problem in Norfolk, and we already got a problem with Langley Air Force Base, which you wouldn't think you would have because the runways are being flooded. This is serious. This is real, and it's not mid-century. It's just a few years away. Now, if you look at the criticality of the U.S. military, particularly the Navy, to the dollar as reserve currency, you know, what we're talking about is the capacity to continue to be the reserve currency, depending on infrastructure, which is not being attended to. And the reality is, who do we have as the leading candidates, according to the polls right now, for president of the United States? A bunch of wealthy lawyers, you know, who have a record of they or their families being very good at running around the world and extracting, you know, bribes from, you know, emerging market countries in exchange for, you know, getting a hold of cheap natural resources or engineering financial fraud. But that's not what you need if you're going to maintain, you know, the infrastructure. And I don't mean just the infrastructure, roads and bridges in the United States. I mean the infrastructure that is the platform upon which the U.S. dollar as reserve currency stands.
Do you have any other panaceas, you know, to help get officials on the right path?
Well, I don't know. The problem we have, Chris, is the United States created the world's greatest financial engineering tool, and that was the U.S. federal credit. And the problem is that the U.S. federal credit has simply, you know, through the reserve currency and through the treasury market, simply over, you know, we have a balance sheet taxation system through the U.S. federal credit and the U.S. dollar. And the problem is if you're not going to preserve the infrastructure upon which that stands, then the only feedback loop that's going to get people to wake up and deal with it is a complete failure. Now, you know, there are a lot of people who've been on GoldSeek explaining the dangers of this, but the reality is we're eating away at both our physical, our spiritual, our cultural, and our financial infrastructure. We've been, you know, extending it while we suck more and more money out. I presume to switch to what I call Global 3.0. Who knows where all this money's going? But you know, we are wearing the whole thing thin, just as when you drive around this country, in many parts of the country, you know, it's now a second or third world infrastructure. The same thing is happening behind the scenes to the financial infrastructure.
We see Illinois up against the ropes. We see, of course, Detroit. It looks as though this issue will accelerate in the years to come.
Well, here's the thing. I had a pastor in Washington who used to say, God does not bless a mess. Plenty of money, there are plenty of resources. So, you know, we say everything's in trouble. If you run things like, you know, Animal House, you're going to get a mess. Doesn't mean it has to be a mess, but it's going to take leadership and it's going to take a lot of change, including cultural change, to turn it around. If you would give me simply half of the money this country spent on gambling, you know, that would be enough resources to turn the whole country around. And the leadership's not making us do that. That we're all doing that of our own free will.
I wonder if we could move on to another interesting Solari report. You discussed in the second quarter equity overview, you call it, a risk analysis that I think would be so helpful for our listeners today. Give us a bullet-by-bullet overview, please.
Basically, what happened in the second quarter, we had a much stronger market in the much stronger markets in the emerging markets than we expected in the first quarter, and you had China run up about 25% year to date, a little bit higher. Same with Germany, and then the second quarter corrected, and the correction continued, and then after the second quarter, after the June 30 close, they were up about 11% on the large Chinese large caps after being up about 26%. Obviously, we had a real meltdown in China for the last sort of period since then. So last 10 days, and Germany held its own. The U.S. market has run up quite a bit for the last 4 years, and I keep saying, you know, and I start to feel really boring, Chris. We are overdue for a 10 to 25% correction. If I say that one more time, I'll make ourselves sick. But the U.S. has had quite a run, and we are way overdue for a correction. I'm a great believer. It looks like we're starting to get that correction. The S&P is flat for the year. It ran up in the first quarter, and now it's flat for the year. China, approximately, depending on what you're looking at, flat for the year. Although year-to-date, they're still very strong. Now, you've seen a lot of fear talk about the Asian markets in the paper as the meltdown occurred over the last week. The reality is we started this year, if you looked at the China ETF, again, I'm using the large cap, China PEs were trading at 9 or 10, and the U.S. is trading at 18. So you have to get this in perspective. Yeah, the China had run up, but it was still, you know, it had run up to 11 or 12 times earnings. It was still very cheap relative to the U.S. markets. Anyway, so which is to say the U.S. and China are both overdue for correction. And, of course, it's summer, and the reality is 95% of the gains in the U.S. stock market occur from November to June. And so way overdue for correction. It's summer, and there's a whole lot of politics going on. And it gets back to the big question, Chris, are we going to make money collaborating or competing? If you look at what the political tensions between the U.S., China, and Russia have been over the last 6 months, that competition has been very, very deflationary to global growth. So we're feeling my number one sort of lead trend for top picks stories in the second quarter was deflation wars. And, of course, part of that is the turn in the bond market, it appears, is finally upon us. Now, my big concern that I keep talking about, and I talked about it again in the second quarter equity overview, is if the U.S. does start to pull up interest rates, even very modestly, it's going to throw a bear trap on the U.S. dollar in the emerging markets. Because coming out of the global financial crisis, 2008-2009, with the bailouts, you know, we made cheap dollars available globally, and we levered up the developing world. Coming into the financial crisis, the developed world was levered up, but not the developing world. We now have people who borrowed cheap dollars all around the world. If dollars get more expensive, you know, the U.S. is going to have a big leash, and that leash is going to get jerked. So the emerging markets, stock markets, have done surprisingly well. But I'm really concerned if the dollar does continue to go up. It was up 12% last year. It's up 5 or 6% so far this year. If the Fed does raise interest rates, we could really see the, you know, sort of global dollar borrowers get clobbered.
You know, I'm certainly expecting the trend to continue here with the greenback. We're most likely going to see a rate hike, as you know, in September, and probably another token rate hike in December. The combination, that impact, probably two and done is what we'll see for a while. But still, you know, the Fed governors and the chair there are talking about around 3% as their target rate over the next several years. So that's going to give the traders the impetus I think they need to back and support the U.S. dollar, but local, our domestic multinationals, which will continue to suffer as a result because of they lose some of that competitive advantage due to the currency play.
Right, and one of the strongest areas in the U.S. markets has been tech after healthcare, and tech has the highest exposure to foreign earnings. So it's going to be. It's going to put quite a headwind on tech.
So many people are riding that momentum play, that trade right now. I mean, that's certainly something to think about. I liked your comments on valuations, and this is something that people are losing sight of.
I do think we're way overdue for 10 to 25% correction. That's only healthy. But here's why I disagree. We have piled high in the bond market trillions and trillions of dollars, and in the derivative market. That money has been stockpiled, and it's been kept out of the real economy because otherwise it would kick off inflation. That money is now going to start to shift into the real economy in a variety of different ways. I mean, if you look at the demands for infrastructure, if we can figure out how to do it, you know, what a great use of the money. But it's going to move out into the real economy now, and we're going to shift to something that's much more equity-based globally in terms of our global investment model. That's a good thing. But that money's got to go someplace. So it's going to go to real estate, it's going to go to commodities, it's going to stay in cash, or it's going to go to equities. And I just think part of what you've been seeing, and it's a lot of it's been happening through the governmental entities, whether it's sovereign wealth funds, central banks, pension funds, it's been moving into the equity markets. The equity markets in 1990, Chris, were globally 11 trillion. Now they're 70 trillion. I think they're going to move up to about 150 trillion, not from price. It's going to be, you're going to see, you know, companies all around the world that are moving. Those emerging markets are going to grow and grow and grow. And the multinationals are going to grow.
Well, that's right. But we're also seeing a systemic shift because, as you know, the 30-year bond market bull is coming to a close here. I mean, obviously, you can't have a bull market amid higher rates. We've seen low rates for so long. There's a whole group of investors out there who have never even invested in an environment that we're about to enter into. So you're going to see a primary shift away from bonds and interest-sensitive investments, of course, into less so, and that makes equities more appealing.
Well, here's the question. Is it going to be away from bonds? Are bonds going to turn, or are they going to plateau?
I would have to be in the camp that agrees with Bill Gross, you know, the former bond king, if you will. It looks like we're going to see a major shift. That's not to say that people won't have bonds in their portfolios. You'll see corporations investing far less of those resources that the Fed has disseminated, as you pointed to earlier, into their own bonds. And you'll see a greater emphasis on their own shares moving forward. And that, of course, those buybacks and related mergers and acquisitions tends to be a solid underpinning for, you know, stock market advances.
You know, that's the challenge the U.S. faces. If you're trading at a relative high PE relative to the world, and a lot of that growth in PE over the last 3 or 4 years has depended on borrowing cheap money and doing buybacks and sort of shrinking your capitalization, you know, what's the next game? If you have to, you know, if you have to create real earnings in a real economy, well, that's why they're pushing for the fast track authority and all these trade agreements. They're trying to figure out a way to jump the curve on corporate earnings over the next 5 to 10 years.
And, you know, there's so many hurdles to overcome there because of, as you say, we've just been focusing on the wrong areas as a society.
Well, here's a funny thing. If you look at what those trade agreements are going to do, they're going to do a couple things. But one is they're going to put enormous stress on your infrastructure. So if you're going to pass all those trade agreements, you better start investing in the infrastructure to handle the growth that you think you're going to get and you're trying to get. And if you're going to do that, maybe you should stop running lawyers for president.
We've just alienated our one lawyer listener, all right?
Well, here's the thing. I love great lawyers. Great lawyers saved my life. There is nothing better in this world than great lawyers. But here's the reality. What we're talking about in terms of Washington, and, you know, because actually one of my favorite congressmen is Alan Grayson, and he's a wealthy lawyer. So, you know, there's exception to every rule. But you can't have everybody be lawyer. You know, that is unhealthy. Balance in all things. And the reality is, you know, I'll never forget. This is a funny story, Chris. I was sitting in my office on Wall Street, and I had a wonderful partner who came in and he said, I'm helping this guy run for Senate and governor in New Hampshire. I want you to come listen to him. And John Sununu walked in, and he sat down, and what he said is, there are no engineers or congressmen, maybe there's one, and I'm a scientist and engineer. Here's how many laws pass a year related to science and engineering, and this is why you should help me. And I wrote a check for everything in my checking account. Every dollar, I gave it to him, and he was absolutely right. And so, you know, it's the same thing. You cannot run a society. If you go back and look at all the great civilizations, you know, they engineered infrastructures that made sure that they won, whether it was in terms of their relationship with nature or their ability to compete with other societies or to manage all the different risks we put up with, let alone having productive, you know, a dense, productive infrastructure that makes humans productive. And it's a critical ingredient. And so you can't just have lawyers. And unfortunately, we have too many lawyers.
Take a look at Teddy Roosevelt, you know, the Rough Rider, that type of generation. Now, that's not to say we need another Theodore Roosevelt in the White House. You know, someone who can bring a wealth of knowledge and background that maybe offsets the pendulum a little bit.
Well, here's the thing. We've got, you know, basically who's risen to power are people who are good at rigging government money and government credit. And if you're going to put your money in the real economy, that is not what creates real returns. You know, I got news for you. Mr. Global just stole $40 trillion. He needs a 5% return. That's $2 trillion a year to run whatever it is. You're not going to get those returns if you're trying to get it with rigging everything with government money, because all you do is destroy the real economy.
How do we encourage folks, how do we foster this need for people in there with the tools, the background, the initiative, the drive, the determination, you know, the spirit, the entrepreneurial spirit, and the wherewithal to accomplish these goals?
If every one of us in our lives, when we're dealing, whether it's we're voting, first of all, your local elections and your local leadership is very important because this cascades bottom up. But, you know, whether you're dealing with your university and your university endowment, because a lot of the shenanigans run through the university endowments, whether you're dealing with the not-for-profits that ask you for money, whether you're dealing with your stock portfolio, whether you're dealing with where you work or, you know, who you buy from, every day as you go through your life and you invest your time and money, say, you know something, I've had it with, I'm not supporting those people, and I'm going to start demanding accountability. I'm not supporting it. It's not fashionable anymore to be a racketeer.
But Catherine Austin Fitts, wouldn't you say that a big component of this story is the entitlement society? And let me just throw in here anecdotally, one of the issues we're facing is when a system sort of reaches that point. I mean, we see this throughout history and we've heard warnings throughout history. When your democracy becomes inundated with people at the top just dishing out to each different group and they're catering to their specific needs, you really set up kind of a self-fulfilling downward spiral.
Yeah, but here's the entitlement that's a problem. The entitlement in our society that's killing us is that people who can kill with impunity can have anything they want. That's the entitlement that's hurting us. And so you have to have government leadership that has the power and the ability to say no without getting their control file slapped all over the Washington Post or, you know, having their children or themselves assassinated. You know, that's the tough issue. There's if you look at what the so-called entitlements, they're tiny compared to, you know, $8.5 trillion has gone missing, you know, primarily from DOD and the intelligence-related agencies. You know, that's the entitlement that's killing us. You know, I think you want to be very careful about the entitlement thing, because now that they've stolen all the money out, they're going to say, oh, well, there's no money. We need to cut back on entitlement. So the reality is that the allocation of capital in the society is done by highly political means, and they relate to who's really good at dirtball. And that's got to be dealt with. And frankly, one of the ways that each one of us can deal with it is stop making the people who do it fashionable. Stop making it socially acceptable to behave that way. So the reality is, you know, we have the greatest power in society is the power to shun. We have the ability to shun these people. The day they stop being fashionable is the day that the people who can build great infrastructure projects, you know, can get in there and do something. I mean, imagine what Wilkerson said. Imagine if we put together a vision of how America could lead economically in terms of building and creating things, not just controlling and destroying things. You know, so we had something to offer the world other than surveillance systems. So imagine if America led, because America to this day, I think, still has for a large, you know, we have great natural resources, we have great sort of an infrastructure base. If half the money that's gone into covert infrastructure has gone in, that I think, then we have a great covert infrastructure.
So. We're a nation of spies. It's certainly food for thought. I wonder if you could give us an idea then how you see this shaping up. If you had to look out into the future, you know, I think you raised the idea of either collaboration or conflict between the BRIC nations. And you bring up, you know, Russia and China. I'm in the camp who seem to believe that, you know, we need to collaborate more, admit our faults, and then we need to see, hey, what's working for them?
Well, here's the thing. I'm not a great believer that anybody got anywhere by showing anybody their jugular. So the reality is, if you look at the BRIC nations, you know, we've played dirtball with them, and I think we have to be careful about how we proceed. But it is absolutely true on any place where we can cooperate in terms of producing excellence in infrastructure and sort of economic well-being globally, we want to do it. And so I think it's a matter of having to be good at multiple things. But we can't just play soft revolution where we dictate, you know, quote-unquote humanitarian terms while playing dirtball. I mean, we're relying too much on force, whether it's covert force or military force. We've got to start competing successfully on, you know, on places where we can cooperate, in areas where we can cooperate. And I think that's one of the reasons they're pushing the fast track, because you're trying to draw in the allies who you believe you can cooperate with.
You know, you talk about exposing the jugular. We are sticking our necks out, I think, economically, and in particular in a monetary fashion, because as we all know, the borrower is slave to the lender. And we have essentially put ourselves up to our eyeballs in debt with many of the BRIC nations. Is this going to be an Achilles heel on a forward basis?
Oh, I don't think so, because we can print, we can pay our debt all day long. They can't print dollars, and they've borrowed dollars. So to me, this is a very, very big leash that we've put out into the developing world. It's going to be interesting to see how we play it. It's one of the backdrops to all of this is proceeding apace this year, robot sales are red hot. And if you look at what's going on with robotics, what we've got is a powerful deflationary force. One of the reasons we haven't experienced monetary inflation is we've had very powerful deflation of labor globally with globalization and automation. And robotics is the next, and artificial intelligence is the next round of that. And it's particularly going to hit the white collar groups.
In line with your thoughts, we're looking at a loss of up to half of the current jobs to automation and robotics over just the next decade. And that's going to be a big shift, don't you think?
It's an enormous shift, and it's a shift that makes politicians very nervous. I mean, part of, I think, of what we're seeing is it's putting tremendous stress, you know, on people who are in responsible political positions to kind of handle that transition. Now, if you look at what we want to do in space, what we have to do with infrastructure, just from the size of the population or the growth in the economy, we need that capacity, but it's a matter of helping people transition from here to there. And America, you know, it's interesting, in the 90s, I sat down and there was a group of leaders in Washington who said, okay, we need to help the American people jump the curve on, you know, on what's coming and retool. And another group said, no, no, let's just lever them up. And that was the plan that got implemented. The reality is when you go through these kinds of transitions, you need to give a pathway to your labor force to retool and transition. You know, the Germans did it, you know, did a great job of that, I think, compared to us over the last, you know, since World War II. And we have traditionally been, you know, hey babes, you're on your own. Let's leave you high and dry. We don't care. And you know, doing that while we're basically stealing their tax dollars. So
in the past, the cliche answer was, well, we'll just all be a nation of, what was it, burger flippers and greeters at Walmart. Well, that's going to soon be gone.
Sure. I'm not sure the greeters are going to be gone, because the customers want to be greeted by a human.
How long before you can't tell the difference before the Turing test is passed?
Don't start me down that topic.
I know. Well, there's so much great topicality that I would love to put before you today. We've already run over on time way too much. We'll have to pick up the conversation, hopefully at a later date. I mean, you have so many venues and areas of interest.
Yeah, actually, what I'm interested in, you know, my goal is to help my subscribers successfully navigate this environment we call free and inspired. You know, sort of no matter what's going on, I want to have a free and inspired life. I want my subscribers to as well. So we tend to look at the full balance sheet. So I'm looking at their balance sheet, and I'm looking at both the macro and micro of what's going on and trying to figure out how they can navigate. And it gets complicated because they're all over the world. It's a big planet. Anyway, so we tend to look at the whole balance sheet, both micro and macro. But I publish the Solari Report. We do a money in markets once a week on Thursday night, except for the last week of the month, and then an interview, so an in-depth interview. And then my favorite part of the Solari Report is quarterly. We do a big wrap-up both on the equity markets, We do a wrap-up on the precious metals markets, and we do a wrap-up. We do the wrap-up of wrap-ups, and it's to help people see the big themes, the big shifts, because what I've discovered is, you know, on any of these topics, if you really want to understand how the money works, there's no way you're going to find it in the sort of the bread and circus entertainment media, the corporate media. You know, they're busy trying to get control of the money, so they're not teaching you how to get control of yours. And then, of course, there's a lot of great stuff on the internet, but a lot of it I find is gloom and doom. And
oh, that's so true. And, you know, it's really asking the fox for security measures on the hen house. That's what we're really looking to. People are turning to the wrong folks, you know, for the information. So it sounds like you have an alternative here.
Well, here's what I believe. The only person who can govern your resources, whether it's your time or your money, is you, and you have to govern it, and you need to get information from a variety of sources. I'm a great believer in sunshine and disclosure, and so, you know, you need to get it, but more than anything, you need to get it in a way that leaves you in a coherent state. So what we're trying to do is we're trying, and there are plenty of risks in this environment, Chris. You know how tricky and dangerous this environment can be, you know, because it's become relatively lawless to what we enjoyed 20 or 30 years ago. But I think you can deal with a lawless environment and still remain coherent. So the Solarium report is basically what we're trying to do is bring you information. And one of the reasons I love the wrap-ups, if you're so busy that you can only read the news four times a year, the wrap-up is designed to make sure you understand what's going on and you have basically the 411 on what's important, and that's all you have to do for the whole year. So if your news diet is only, you know, 10 hours a year, then get the Solarium report wrap-ups.
Oh, exactly. And if you're also experiencing information overload, as so many of us are, I have Solarium.com and the blog bookmarked right now on my website, and I want to encourage everybody to do so. It's Solarium.com/blog. Catherine Austin Fitts, great information. Please return to the show.
Have a great day, Chris, and thanks for the opportunity again to be on your show. Great show.